मुझे टेप दे दीजिए।
नमस्कार नमस्कार, कैसे?
थैंक यू। नहीं ऊपर पंखा
तो पीछे की तरफ बिल्कुल एसी नहीं है, और ये जो है ना वो ग्रीन हाउस वगैरह में वो सब चीज है।
The only prayer to God that I have, that give me enough strength, that I'm able to serve Him through dance till the last dying breath.
Take us back to your first stage performance. Today I am what it is because of the first stage performance. To me, it feels as though it happened yesterday.
But it is destiny somewhere or the other which has taken you to these heights, and that performance played a very major role.
Major role. There was a stage rehearsal a day prior to the actual show, and all the contestants were called. I looked at everybody and I froze. Mm. You know, when in our Indian mythology we say, you know, Ahilya Shila ban gay, you know, she turned into a stone. I had become that. Came back and I got the thrashing of my life. Mm-hmm. And my mother said, my God, you dramatist and this and that. You were the one. It, you know how parents are. Nothing moved me till one sentence. All this drama has to end and no more dance for you, because you're the one who's a great dramatist and no more dance. Mm-hmm. The moment I heard no more dance for me, it was like a dam bursting. Mm. I started shrieking and saying, I have to dance. You cannot stop my dance. Next day I went and danced and I came back with the first prize. If I looked at it from a traditional Kathak, the thing, I came from a totally non-gharanedar family, because I came from an educated family, well-placed family. But I went to the different gharanas. I did learn from both the two major gharanas, including my first guru who introduced me to Kathak, Ta Thei Thei Tat, my Shadhana boss. But Kundalal ji and Birju Maharaj ji, they really gave me solid grounding in Kathak. I personally look upon Kathak as a form and a medium of expression. It's a language for me. And just as we all go to schools and colleges and we educate ourselves, we hone our skills and, you know, and our expertise, after that it's up to us to what to make of it. And so for me, similarly, Kathak is beyond gharanas because it is that ever flowing tradition and river and a mode of expression, a language of expression. Gharanas are a part of a branch. It is a stream. It's one way of thinking, of looking at it, of treating it. But Kathak is that ever flowing larger tradition. When I look at Kathak references, and when we talk, this is our tradition, I'm always wondering what is tradition, because in my own life, I'm 65 years old. In my own life, from the 50s till now, I've seen so many changes in all dance forms. Same guru, same performer, that did something else X years ago, did something else Y years ago, and had a different approach and attitude today. So now, even in my when I was there, every movement had to be the person, then it's totally, this has gone down, the basic movement. So even the positioning of the basic hand changes from guru to guru, period to period. And the same guru, I would say also, it changes hands. So it's, there's no absolute. And so when we say we all have this, in our culture, this happened. In our culture, that happened. The culture also, it's a very, very evolutionary process and it keeps changing.
Our costume is extremely suggestive, so let's be on the simplistic suggestive side.
You know, we're not doing a woman trying to be male. We're doing two ladies, two women, but acting a man.
Characters.
Yeah, characters.
I mean, it's not acting a man or a woman, but it's just the two characters.
Reflective. She's a thinking dancer. You know, I don't think anybody has touched upon the topic of incest or done environment way back in 84 or touched upon the racism, the discrimination in, gender discrimination, of course, even apartheid, which we did in 86, 87. So as far back as that, when, you know, she was doing topics which were unheard of in the Kathak realm. You dealt with the traditional Krishna Radha, of course, that is part of it. But she pushed the envelope, she really did. And all these things came into the gamut of the Kathak world, which I don't think was there so much.
Somewhere within me, there's a search. There's an inner search. There's a which is not at the super. I don't have to put on a persona to show that I'm searching, and that I am. But it's deep within.
Subhna Narayan ji, आप सब जानते हैं हिंदुस्तान की जानी मानी हस्ती कथक नृत्यांगना. हिंदी, अंग्रेजी और भोजपुरी तीनों में लिखती हैं और बहुत अच्छा लिखती हैं.
सबसे पहले तो मैं माफ़ी चाहती हूँ सब लोगों से कि मैं तो नृत्यांगना हूँ, कोई कवित्री को हूँ नहीं, और अगर अगर लिखती हूँ तो जरूरत पड़ जाती, कभी मन कर जाता है तब लिख देती हूँ। और शायद जिस परिवेश में मैं पली बड़ी हूँ उसका कहीं ना कहीं शायद उसमें कुछ खुशबू आ जाती है। मेरी माँ समाज सेविका थी तो उनके साथ बहुत गांव में जाने का मौका मिला, तो वही एक उसका एक सखी कैसन बदलल जीवन वारे, सखी कैसन बदलल जीवन वारे, जे ओढ़नी सिसु के कोठल रहे, बनल आज पिंजर वारे।
आई हैव ग्रोन अप with Hindi and Sanskrit literature. When I say Hindi, meaning in the larger Hindi world. It has Avadhi in it, it has Bundelkhandi in it, it has Maithili in it, it has Bhojpuri in it, it has Magahi in it. And at the same time, because of I have been educated in convent schools throughout, I'm extremely familiar with the English literature scenario also. I was given translations of a lot of Bengali works. So I've grown up with reading translations of the entire pantheon of Sharad Chandra Chattopadhyay, Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay, and whatever of Tagore was available. And so that I think has given me a very solid base. And it was because of that I was exhorted at home to look beyond and not be a frog in the well. If you take Amir Khusro, kya Amir Khusro, look at his verses, look at Ghalib and the way he's talked about Banaras, that great ode to Banaras. So you go beyond all compartmentalization.
To mention that when I was searching for Kathak villages and looking at the land records and the DM in one of the villages over there in the headquarters said, here is a man who is a great scholar of the Ramayana, and would you believe what his name was? Pandit Abdul Hamid Shastri. So here it is, a person of an Islamic faith, but who, because of his shastrarth, that you know, and his knowledge, he was given the title of Pandit and the Shastri, and he was a great repository of knowledge as far as the Ramayana is concerned. Dance has helped me to find my balance too, because it has been my
expression. It has been all my energies, positive, negative, indifferent, whatever energies has gone into it, because it has given me that sense of harmony. I can't find another word of, a sense of harmony within. For me, Kunti, I can see the good and the bad of Kunti. I can also see the good and bad of Kekei. Or even I can even see Ravan. I don't only see Ravan as the great, the Sita Haran karne wala, but he is also the great scholar, a Sanskrit scholar. So you learn to appreciate the myriad facets of every aspect. At home, I was schooled in Indian classical music. I used to learn it, sing it, but I loved Western classical music. And I remember when we used to come back from school, 2 o'clock, there used to be for 15 minutes on Delhi B, Western classical music and late night Western. I used to hear it for those 15 minutes in the afternoon and 15 minutes at night. So I've grown up with Bach, Beethoven, Schubert, Mozart, Vivaldi. And it was so very, very natural for me to grow up in both worlds.
Person who had so many, it was an amalgam of so many qualities. She was a loving person and a person who just loved music. So the first thing was that our house was open. She respected every musician. So we had musicians who stayed with us for 6 months. There was nobody, no artist who left our house without my mother, despite the servants going into the kitchen and personally making the food for the artist. My father, in fact, was a person with a great sense of humor. He was the quieter. So when Shobhana was young, she was more like my father in terms of being quieter, but he would encourage us. It was, my mother would say, no, no, no. He would say, no, she's a, why would she go at 12 at the age of 10 and dance 10 saal ke bachcha with a beti 10 raat ke 12 baje tak? And my father would get angry and not go to the theater. But my sister would, and I would always be the one who would be tagging along everywhere. When Shobhana was dancing, when her item came on, my father was the one who, and my parents were sitting right in the front. He would come. He would make all the noise at home, but he would come. Ma was just
Wonderful, wonderful. But she kept that balance between education and the arts because she felt both were important to the development of personality.
First of all, dancer meant you're not supposed to take up something like physics. And here I was taking up physics, which again went totally against the grain. So everybody wrote me off, this side and that side and every sides you can think of. Now, when you managed to swim through, then I went into civil service. Then you've had it. Everybody said, civil service? Come on, forget it. I mean, nobody took me seriously for a long time.
Kathak takes its name from Katha, a tradition that is 2,000 years old.
More than that.
More than that. So I want you to tell our viewers about the history of Kathak.
You know, Kathak is a Sanskrit word. And as you very rightly said, it takes its name from Katha, Kathakar. And the earliest reference that you find, inscription, even predates the Natyashastra. Mm. It is from 4th century before Christ. It's a Prakrit inscription. And in the Ashokan Brahmi script, which is there in the Kameshwar archives at Darbhanga, and which says, Gangaye maha nadiye tate sabbo kathaka bhingar natenam stutiti sikayam ehi raya adinaho bhavenam pasai. In other words, it means that the dance of the Kathaks on the banks of the Ganges at Varanasi are doing a stuti, dancing a stuti in praise of the Almighty, pleased Adina. I was dancing at Bodh Gaya festival and one journalist asked me, will you be going to the Kathak village? I just sort of blinked. I kept quiet. I thought he was pulling my leg. But it turned out there were 3 Kathak villages. So then we took on this whole project, a very serious project. So a friend of mine, an IAS from Punjab cadre, She, I, and assistant professor from Calcutta University, we all then started looking into it. We went to all the 8 Kathak villages, took out the land records from 150 years ago, 140 years ago, photographed them, and then that research is going on. 1.5-2 years ago, I'm looking at the census figures, 2011 census figures, and I find Kathak villages, 5 more Kathak villages. And I said, even till today, in our census, we are calling it Kathak villages. So here it is right under our noses, and we just don't know about it.
Actually been able to see a living tradition at the grassroots, which is really proving the fact that Kathak is a very old indigenous culture at the grassroots. You know, that it is not something that was started by Bajad Ali Shah or started in the court of Akbar or Jahangir or something like that. It is far deeper roots.
As a young student, you're learning from various teachers, various gharanas, and everyone talks in terms of, you know, each gharana talked about how Kathak emanated in their household, etc. And then you read the miracle plays of Mathura, and then, you know, Kathak is mentioned, being mentioned the Mahabharata, the shlok from Adipar about Kathak. Kathakashcha pare rajan shravanashcha vanaukasa divya khyanani ye chapi patanti madhuram bija. Kathaks have been mentioned in the Mahabharata. You see that Prakrit inscription. You have Kathaks mentioned later on in Ban Harsharit. You have Kathaks mentioned, there's one in solitary or two solitary references to Kathak in the Sangeet Ratnakar, and so on and so forth. What was it? The spirit of Kathak, in its broader form, in its essence, has continued over the last 2.5 million. And that is what is important, because that gives it continuity, that ensures its continuity, and then it ensures that this flow will go on. And interestingly, very patriarchal society all over India and very casteist. All those dance forms which had a male origin were usually done by male high castes. Kathak, male Brahmins. Kuchipudi, Siddhendra Yogi, Brahmin, male. And traditionally it was done by males. Kathakali, upper caste, Nambudris, males. They never changed their names.
Dasi Atta, done by women, outskirts of society. So I think, but it just speaks the hypocrisy of the mindset of society. We are such hypocrites in society.
Everybody knows Didi, how generous and warm she is, and that's what translates into her relationship as a guru as well. But she can be very tough as a guru. I remember there was this room in her house in Pandara Road which had these squares. That room had these square tiles all over. It was a small room. And that the correspondingly, the tile was, I think, should have been 12 by 12 or 16 by 16. So we used to start doing our chakkar ka riyaz on that square, in that square, within that square. We could not step out. And if 1 foot went out, we used to start all over again. So we used to do something like 30 odd chakkars, pirouettes within that square. And it was excruciating because it was torturous to do it like that. But yes, it really honed our skills at that time. So she is very exacting in what she wants, but that has stood all of us in very good stead.
I started when I was 6 and I'm 23 now, so it's been that long. Her teaching is so personal that she gives more than just dancing to her students. Whether we're actually being taught just movements, there is going to be a backstory to it.
But if it is, it has to go like that.
We've done shows where we had barely 15 people in the audience, and she said every single person's important. Every single stage is as important as the one where you'd probably have 500 or 1,000 people seated. And I think that truly is her legacy.
She gave me so much opportunity. She gave me, the stage. I did not come to dancing with the view of dancing professionally, but I stayed because of her, you know. So she made it something bigger than it was for me. And I think till today, I don't realize that it's actually that, but she's the one who's done it single-handedly. I have no contribution to that. I just sort of went along with what was happening. So I found my guru, and that's what's kept me going now. I've been there for 10 years.
Before time, because you don't want to arrive
out. But nobody really has ever done that. Till it's not possible.
You know that the musicians call Didi clock. No? They call
Ghadi.
They call her Ghadi because she's so punctual.
Yeah. And then she starts sending messages as soon as. So inevitably the message arrives before any of us do. Where are you girls? And then she names everyone. You know, so then two will arrive and the three who are missing their names. You know?
My grandchildren.
So I always had a dream of, you know, wanting to learn Kathak and very specifically Lucknow Gharana Kathak. But unfortunately, the city I was growing up in, we didn't have any dance teacher. I turned 35 last year, 2015, and I had this conversation with myself where I realized that I don't want to die and regret that only had I done it. And I realized that if I have to do it, this is the time to do it. Most teachers, when you go in at the age of 35 and start learning, they kind of believe that you're doing it just as, you know, something like a hobby. I was here in Delhi for some personal work, and there was this sense of, you know, desperation at that point. And so I just went to Mandi House. I said, that's the place where I know Katha Kendra used to be and the others, and, you know, something I'll be able to figure out for myself. And I was just standing there on road and looking at my Google on my phone, and I was like trying to search who could I talk to, who could I contact. And I literally had tears at that point in my eyes because I was desperate and I was just going crazy. And I don't know why, of all numbers, of all those people and all those dance schools which were showing up on Google, I just chose to call up Didi. And exactly like how it was for you. So I called up and she said, hello, this is Shobhana Narayan. And I was like, and I had nothing to say. And then I was like, okay, calm down. I said, I'm so-and-so and I've come down from Bombay and I'm 35 and I want to learn. So I never expected, one, I never expected her to pick up the phone. Two, I never expected her to say that, okay, come and meet me. And I was like, really? And I was like, excited. I can't tell you. I just called up my husband and I was like, you know what? I'm going to meet her. And I just hope she accepts me as a disciple. And because I didn't know whether I would be accepted at this age. And you know, a whole lot of things which people kind of judge you on in general. So the next day I reached the place and Didi is there and I start having a chat with her. And she was very honest with me. And that level of acceptability, the level of honesty, not once did she say that you would not be able to do it, but she also kind of very clearly, she did say that it's not going to be easy, it's going to be a difficult path. It might even, and one thing which I always remember, which she said that, you know, there are going to be times when you will feel frustrated because you want to learn faster and your body might not be able to, but then, you know, those are the trying times for you and you have to kind of live with it. And then I said, fine, I'm still willing to do it. And I was here only for that week. So she said, fine, come to the class next day. And she asked me to come at 2:30. And I reached there and she was already there as usual. Like I said, Didi is the first one to reach. One full hour for someone like me who had never learned dance ever. And she corrected my tatkar. I mean, I had learned for about 4 months and she corrected my tatkar. And one full hour she gave to me and then everyone else started coming in. And she said, you know, you could stand at the back and do as much as you can. I said, okay. And then I said that only in March will I be able to come because I'll have to go back, resign from my job. Also, you know, kind of take care of household stuff and all. And she said, sure. So I still remember the day I resigned, I was going back home and I texted her saying that I have put in my papers and I'll see you on March 15th. And she said, are you sure? And I said, yes, I am willing to take the risk. And the reply that I received was, so both of us need to put in a lot of hard work. And that was the time when I knew for myself that this is my guru, for sure. I mean, someone actually willing to put in that kind of something.
I've been asked so many times, why haven't you made an institution? When an institution means a concrete institution, why are you teaching in somebody's, you know, at the mercy of some friend of yours and this? Is the concrete building more important or the building up of artists more important? I may be wrong, but for me, building up of individuals as artists and as good human beings, to me, I don't know, personally I give it greater precedence over building a concrete wall. Secondly, I don't want to, once I die, I don't want to leave behind a mess. So for me, personally, I feel material possession is not so important. It is very, very important for me to see wherever I could even teach under a tree. And that is so, but under that tree also, I would like to see that these children who learn under a tree actually emerge as good artists and good human beings.
Had some really good times, you know, and I think that bond, and she's very approachable. She's like, you know, after her makeup comes off, she's like just like one of us. So we have a great time otherwise.
Actually, मैं एक सीनियर वेरी सीनियर ब्यूरोक्रेट की लड़की थी लेकिन फिर भी कार हमारे बसेस में जाओ और उस समय सेकंड क्लास या थर्ड क्लास
में कोयले वाले इंजन
कोयले वाले और हम लोग और अनरिजर्व्ड और जाओ और फिर उसके बाद
वो खड़े खड़े मतलब
कई बार तो हम लोग बाथरूम के सामने बैठ के आए हैं
कई बार नहीं काफी बार
वी ऑल स्टार्टेड आउट वेरी अर्ली working together and then over a period of time you start bonding, you understand, they understand you, you understand, and with that understanding, you know, then a sort of a team, it becomes a family. Unsaid dictum that a dancer is only married to a dance, she cannot get married. You know, I mean, that was, and look, whoever's got married had to have a broken family home and all. Oh, those were the kind of the atmosphere that was prevailing in those days. And here I was again swimming against the tide by again marrying somebody, a foreigner, but a long-distance marriage, which was more important, long-distance marriage, which was again a complete no-no. I hurt. My sister hurt. She was so worried that everybody's within 2 months of our marriage, they said the marriage is breaking up. Everywhere, oh, you know, we heard that the marriage was breaking up. I don't know from where they hear, but it's been 34 years, and the fact that I'm happily married. My son and I have fantastic, you know, we have good mother-son relationship. So it's a normal family life. It takes a long while for people to understand and appreciate, but they do. Actually, both of us are professionals. My dear husband was his country's representative ambassador in different countries. I was here with my two full-fledged careers. One in the civil service, one as a classical dancer. So I was really Delhi bound, you know, grounded in India. And so I must say, he's been very patient, very understanding.
Look, we are all this. We know that we have adapted to each other's life and career. And that one has to accept. That's why I fell in love with her. So one has to accept that and not trying to change the other person. I think that's a major, major key in that way. At the end, I think we both, she, do not have the thinking that a marriage is something which you do just off the cuff and something like that. We both believed and believe in the permanence of that. So of course one has hesitations and one has that. She had it.
I had a lot.
And those very suspicious Farangis. You never know what they are doing, those white fellows, those Goras. I mean, life is not always only sunshine and blue sky. So one has things to discuss where one does not necessarily see eye to eye. Today, you could take your mobile and call again 5 minutes later. At that time, you couldn't. And you didn't get through. So the communication was much, much, much more difficult, and it demanded more patience.
But we also, you know what we did? We used to send audio cassettes to each other. So during our
once
courtships,
a week.
As well as all through our married life, we sent audio cassettes. So 1 hour.
You sit down. I wasn't drinking whiskey then, have my glass of wine, and start talking on the audio cassette. Send the audio cassette, and she would send hers. So usually about once a week, we would send audio cassettes. And that, I think, you know, it replaced to a certain extent for us the letter writing.
Lovely, yes, lovely.
I think the abiding, what should I say, the factor between both of them is one of respect. She has tremendous respect for Herbert Saab, you know, for and so does Herbert Saab for Didi, you know, and for their respective professions. She gives him his due completely. When he was ambassador, she used to be standing there in the traditional Austrian dress as an ambassador's wife. And when you see Herbert Saab, when he's attending Shobhana Didi's performance, he's the dancer's husband. So I think they are able to submerge their personalities when it comes to the other's profession or anything to do with that, which is wonderful.
Grow old together.
getting old together. That I've said from the beginning. So whatever, I mean, comes, accept that, live it together through the good times, through the difficult times. That's what it is.
Life has been testing me, challenging me every now and then. In the year 2000, I suddenly had a brain stroke. And I've lost half my vision in both my eyes. Suddenly, out of the blue, I developed an allergy
to ultraviolet rays and to perfumes. And I used to love perfumes. And then much later I found out that when I hyperpigmentation started and it started spreading and spreading in a very rather brutal way. And then I had to go through skin biopsies, and then they found what I was suffering from. Then I suddenly found that my knees were giving way. And so I was advised this replacement. That's why I said nothing is going to be replaced. Whatever I am till I die. That's it.
Lalit Tarpan Festival, we've been doing it. This is the 15th edition, and we've been doing that every year. And I would like to thank everyone who has helped us in this journey.
On stage, for some time you're the artist and there's the art. But then there comes a time when the artist submerges to the art, with the art. Now that is the point of that actual ecstasy and anand that we're talking about. That happens. So that is the point when the artist has become the art. And that is, those are the points which we all remember.